What's up, y'all? Welcome back to Fish the Moment. Have you ever been in the lake with your fish finder and grabbed a big school of fish that you thought were bass? You then spun around and cast the bait down there, but no matter what you did, you could not get those fish to bite. This is something that happens to all offshore anglers, and it's really frustrating. So in this video, I want to explain why you can't catch those fish you see on your fish finder, and show you exactly what catchable fish look like on your fish finder so you can put a ton more fish in the boat offshore this year. Let's get into it. Let's start by taking a look at this down imaging image. I'm sure some of you guys watching this are already getting excited taking a look at this picture. If we look at the center of the screen, you can see that there are several dots. This is actually a school of bass that's positioned 2 to 3 feet off the bottom. There are two indicators that will allow you to identify this group of dots as a school of bass. The first is that the dots are spread more horizontally than vertically. If these dots were stacked on top of each other in a vertical column, this would be a group of crappie or any other type of panfish. However, because these dots are spread more horizontally and they're not that tall, this usually indicates that you're looking at a group of bass. The second indicator that these dots are bass is that the dots are spread apart and there's some black space between each of the dots. In general, bass like to have their own personal space or a personal bubble. They don't like to get too close to each other. If these dots were really close to each other, these might be catfish, white bass, or any other species of fish. However, because these dots are spread apart from each other and they're spread more horizontally than vertically, I can identify them as bass. For anyone who didn't fully understand the explanation or has no idea what you're looking at on the screen here, I've made detailed videos explaining how a down imaging image is created and how to interpret your fish finder, both from your down imaging, side imaging, Livescope, and I'm gonna link all those videos down in the description below. So check those videos out if you want some more basic instruction on your fish finder. But for now, I wanna talk about a little more advanced topic for anglers who know how to understand their fish finder and interpret images like the one you see on your screen here. Now that we've identified these dots as bass, you'd expect that you could idle back around the spot, drop your trolling motor, and make a cast exactly where you saw those fish. You can do this by either dropping a marker buoy or using a waypoint on your fish finder. And I have another video explaining how to hit offshore areas first cast every time, so check that video out if you want a more detailed explanation. However, in this situation, even though we marked bass on our fish finder, dropped a waypoint on the exact spot, and are casting right where those fish were 5 minutes ago, if you tried to fish this spot on this fishing day, you would not get a single bite, and you have not caught a single fish. And I'm sure many of you have experienced this before on the water if you tried to fish offshore. What's happening is that the fish you mark on your fish finder are not actually related to the bottom or to any sort of cover. Instead, those fish are swimming around randomly in the middle of the lake, and you just happen to drive over those fish at the exact moment they were at that one location. However, by the time you drove 20 or 30 feet to the right, stopped the engine and dropped the trolling motor, those fish had swam 10 to 20 yards away from where you initially marked them. Basically, these fish are migratory, or they're swimming around the lake, and they're not locked in on one spot. Therefore, if you mark with a waypoint the exact spot those fish were, in 5 minutes, they're no longer going to be anywhere near that waypoint, and you're basically just casting in the middle of the ocean in dead water where there are no fish. Based on my experience, I find that there are three reasons why bass schools become migratory. The first is that they're trying to move from one location to another due to a seasonal change. For example, you may have a school of bass that's setting up on a main lake point in the mouth of a creek. They may even stay there for 2 to 3 weeks, which makes them a stationary school of bass, which I'll explain in a little bit. However, due to seasonal changes or weather changes, these bass want to move further into the creek and set up in a new location. That new location may be the secondary point halfway back in this creek. Therefore, these bass need to make a move between that main lake point and the secondary point. However, these bass aren't just going to magically teleport from the main lake point to the secondary point. They have to make a journey between the two locations. While they're doing this, they may stop off on a bank or a certain offshore area for 20 minutes or maybe one day to feed up while they continue their journey. However, most of the time those bass are going to be on the move from point A to point B. Then, once those fish finally reach the secondary point in the middle of the creek, they'll set up on that spot for 2 to 3 weeks again. What you'll find then is that if you're graphing between point A and point B while those bass are making their move, you may inadvertently graph over those school of fish as they're moving. The second reason schools of bass may become migratory is because they detach themselves from structure and cover and focus on chasing bait fish. This happens a lot on blueback herring lakes and lakes with big gizzard shad. Rather than relating to structure and cover, these schools of bass will relate to big schools of bait fish. They'll follow the bait fish wherever they go, and I've sometimes followed a school of bass chasing a school of bait fish 200 to 300 yards around the lake in a matter of a couple of hours. This means that these bass are a little bit tricky to track down because the only way you can find them is by locating the bait fish. However, unlike those migratory bass that are moving from point A to point B in the back of a creek, these bass that are chasing schools of shad are a little bit easier to catch because usually you can find times when they're actively feeding on those bait fish. I've made a video about this recently using the Garmin Livescope to follow around big schools of gizzard shad in the middle of the lake, and 5 and 6 pound bass would come up and eat them near the surface of the water, even in the winter time. You can check out that video using the link up above and down in the description, and it's a really fun way to catch fish, though it can be a little bit frustrating. The third reason, which is by far the most common, is a change in weather or lake conditions, whether that's current flow, a cold front, or a change in sun or clouds. I don't have time to get into that in this video, but I am going to be doing a seminar on fishthemoment.com dedicated to how different weather pattern changes and lake condition changes affect bass movement both during a specific day and over a series of weeks. It's going to be a great seminar that will help you learn how to better adapt to changes on the water, put a lot more fish in the boat. If you enjoyed this video so far, I would highly recommend signing up for that seminar over at fishthemoment.com. On the flip side, we have stationary bass, which are bass that set up on one specific spot, like an offshore ledge or maybe an offshore brush pile, for an extended period of time, 1 to 2 weeks. In the example we looked at earlier, the main lake point and the secondary point are two of these locations that these bass may choose to set up on for an extended period of time. While these bass are there, they're basically going to use any available cover like rocks, brush piles, or grass as an ambush point to feed on the available bait fish in the area, whether that's shad, bluegill, or crawfish. Stationary schools of bass are much easier to catch than migratory schools of bass because they're going to be set up on the exact same spot. This means that if you graph over them one time with your fish finder and then re-graph the exact same area, those fish will still be in that same general area. They're not going to move in the time it takes you to drop your trolling motor and cast down in that spot. Therefore, if you locate a good stationary school of bass, you can actually catch those fish day after day after day, which makes them very consistent for a tournament fisherman or if you're just going to fish on the same lake multiple times over a 2 week period. Now that you hopefully understand the difference between migratory schools of bass and stationary schools of bass, let me explain how I differentiate them using my fish finder. What I'll do is graph over an offshore area, and if I identify fish on the fish finder, I will then turn around and re-graph that exact same spot maybe once, twice, or even three times to ensure that that school of bass has not moved. Now, I'm sure many of you may be hesitant to do this because you may feel like graphing over the same school of fish over and over again would spook the school and make them hard to catch. However, if you've watched any of my YouTube videos before, I almost always re-graph my offshore areas 2 to 3 times, not only to make sure those fish are in a stationary school, but also to get sonar images for these videos. And I still catch plenty of fish regardless of the fact that I re-graph and drive over these spots over and over again before fishing them. Now, for those of you who are still hesitant about graphing over the same school of fish 2 or 3 times, another option is to use forward-facing sonar. For example, you can graph over a school of fish and then spin your boat back around, drop the trolling motor, and use either Garmin Livescope or 360 imaging to see if there are fish in front of the boat in the exact spot you graphed. If you point your Livescope or 360 imaging at the spot where you graph those fish and there are no longer fish there, it means that those fish are a migratory school of fish, and therefore you probably shouldn't waste your time fishing that area. The only reason that I would recommend fishing for those fish is if you see them actively feeding on bait fish or you know there are bait fish in the area. In this case, it may be worth your time to use your Livescope to follow around that school of fish and see if they intersect with the school of bait fish at some point. Again, you can check out my video explaining how to use Livescope to chase around these migratory fish that are feeding on shad. And again, it's a really productive way to catch fish, if not a little bit frustrating and inconsistent. And really quickly, guys, for those of you who are interested in getting a Garmin Livescope but haven't pulled the trigger yet, Garmin is offering a $200 rebate on the Panoptic system, and you can check that out either on Garmin's website or by going over to thebasstank.com. Basstank is who I use to install all my fish finders, and they can explain all of the details of this rebate and how it works. So definitely check that out and take advantage of this deal if you're in the market for a Livescope. To show you guys how important this concept is, let me explain a recent fishing trip I took to one of my local lakes in February. I got to the lake early and started graphing for 2 or 3 hours offshore in anywhere from 10 to 30 feet of water. After about an hour and a half of graphing, I started noticing some schools of fish in anywhere from 10 to 15 feet of water positioned on offshore rock. However, whenever I would graph over these schools of fish and then re-graph over them with my fish finder, I found that the schools had disappeared. Therefore, I had a feeling these fish were migratory schools of fish, so I dropped the trolling motor and started following them around with my Livescope. My intention was to follow these schools of fish around long enough to see if they would intersect with a school of baitfish and start feeding. While I was doing this, I threw a ton of different baits at these fish, from small swim baits, jerk baits, Alabama rigs, pretty much everything in my tackle box, and I was not able to get a single bite from these fish. I actually found 2 migratory schools of fish halfway back in the creek, and I followed them around for quite a bit of time before I finally decided to just give up on trying to catch them, because after 3.5 hours of trying, I didn't get a single bite. Instead, I started graphing for isolated targets in a little bit deeper water, anywhere from 15 to 25 feet of water. What I found is that the bass that were positioned a little bit deeper were in stationary schools, and every time I'd graph over an area 2 or 3 times, those fish would still be there. Here's actually a recording from my Livescope of the first brush pile I found, and you can see that a school of bass is set up right next to this brush pile, and I've sped up the footage to show you that they don't move over about a 5-minute period of time. Because these fish are in a stationary school, they're in an ambush mode, and they're basically waiting for bait fish to come by that brush pile. Therefore, I threw my go-to bait, the fish moment offshore jig, in that brush pile, and within 3 casts, I had a really nice fish in the boat to start the day. I continued graphing in that 15 to 25 foot range and started consistently putting fish in the boat. Nothing huge, but I had some nice keepers, and I lost a really good one that I think was anywhere from 4 to 5 pounds that came off right near the boat. I was fishing in post-front conditions, and given how tough the fishing had been on this lake and how tough the conditions were, I was really happy with my results. I basically wasted 3.5 hours in the morning chasing these migratory schools of fish without success. And then after making a game plan change and fishing for about 4 hours for those stationary fish, I was able to almost put a limit in the boat if I caught that one fish I lost and had a pretty good day. Therefore, if you're struggling to catch fish offshore, I would highly recommend trying to identify if the fish you're seeing on your graph are stationary fish or migratory fish. For intermediate and beginner anglers, I would recommend trying to fish for those stationary fish, because once you identify them with your fish finder, they're going to stay in one location, and you can work on dialing in your casting to hit those offshore spots and usually put some good fish in the boat. And that's it for this video, guys. If you made it to the end, you're definitely a bass fishing nerd just like me. Let me know down in the comments below if you made it to the end and what you thought of the video. If you really enjoyed, I would appreciate if you left a like on the video. It helps us with the YouTube algorithm and gets this video out to more people. Really appreciate all the support we've been getting on both fishmoment.com and on the YouTube pages recently. You guys are amazing, and we couldn't be doing all of this without you. So thanks for the support, and hopefully you guys are enjoying the videos, and I'll see y'all next one.